Disappointment comes in many forms. We have all watched a movie or a TV show, or even read a book or a comic that did not deliver. Sometimes it's in regards to how a story ends. Others is in regards to how a story just loses its quality over time, either due to repeat storylines, the writer running out of ideas, or the series continuing past where it should have ended. This is one of those stories. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, we're retreading Brian K. Vaughan's attempt at a magnum opus. Once again, we are diving into the series known as Saga. Written by Brian K. Vaughan and illustrated by Fiona Staples, Saga takes place in a universe that has two primary warring factions. The technologically advanced world of Landfall, populated by winged people who can fly, and Wreath, the moon that orbits it. Its population is that of horned individuals that use magic instead of technology. The series focuses on an unlikely couple, Marco and Alana, with their daughter Hazel, as they try to live in this crazy universe that's out to get them for simply existing. As the series unfolds, we are introduced to other characters that go on their own journeys that occasionally cross paths with our main trio. Now, what made Saga a fun comic to read was seeing essentially a family story take place in this massive universe. From the get-go, you are told by the narrator Hazel, as she's presumably older. Granted, you're never really told specifically how old she is. We're given hints here and there, but nothing concrete. We're told that she was never a great warrior or the galaxy's savior. There is never a story arc where a main character has to stop a planet from blowing up or stop a massive conspiracy, but from start to hopefully finish, Saga is very much a character-driven series. Something would happen to our main trio, and that would affect what would happen to them down the line. Also, despite being a series that occasionally deals with heavy subject matter and themes such as childhood trauma, abuse, PTSD, and war crimes, Saga knows when to draw back and make a joke. It knew when to make light of certain situations. And since Brian had worked in television writing before, one of the core aspects of this series was to make it as unadaptable as possible. For at least a solid 20 or so issues, each issue's beginning page would always be something a tad outlandish. You'll be seeing some of the most insane, almost gratuitous sexual shit on the planet, and it's honestly just there for shock, but it's done in a way to get a quick laugh. Not only that, but there would also be sometimes be a page where something insane happens, and the best part would be seeing how other characters in that situation would react to it. The art by Fiona is also something that does demand praise. Having reread the series several times, it's always astonishing seeing how the art looked at issue 1 and seeing how good it got just up to issue 6 and onwards. There are many moments in this series where I just had to pause and just marvel at the pages. There are many iconic moments in this series, and even revisiting them like still gets me giddy sometimes. In regards to characters, seeing Hazel, the daughter of Marco and Alana, grow as the series continues from the very beginning, you see her birth and onwards, see her grow from age 4 to 7 to currently 11 years old. Since she was born in the very first issue, it's a clever way to know how many years it's been in the universe since the story started. Hazel in the beginning is very much the bond that holds Marco and Alana together and embodies the innocence in the world of Saga, a world where, despite where there being suffering, where two races are in eternal war with each other, she shows that there might be some semblance of hope, that if Marco and Alana found happiness, maybe others might as well. And seeing Hazel talk and act her age adds to the relatability of this series, despite it being a space opera of sorts. Now, I will admit, Marco, Hazel's father, might be my favorite character in Saga, mostly due to his story. Similar to his wife Alana, Marco was a soldier in the Wreath Army until he was imprisoned, Alana being his guard and later his wife. And after Hazel is born, Marco does his best to swear off violence to the best of his abilities. In the very first issue, he makes a vow to never pull a sword from his scabbard, a vow he breaks later on when he is met with no other choice. We're also shown that Marco, despite his best efforts, does have a bit of a violent impulse, something he wrestles with throughout the series. We see time and again Marco trying his best to be a pacifist, only be brought down to use the tools he regrets to use. Now, there have been other characters like Marco in other media, but they can often come across as hypocritical or even short-sighted. But Brian's writing is different because there are several instances where other characters point out the flaws in Marco's logic. Though you know this is something on purpose, that this is a character flaw, and despite that flaw, Marco does his best for his family. And one of the best aspects of Marco's journey was seeing his growth and actually accept that nature of himself and to use it in a positive light to actually protect people rather than give in to his violent impulses, actually strive and actually have a reason to fight for something. Alana, Marco's wife and Hazel's mother, is also a ton of fun throughout the series. As mentioned earlier, the banter back and forth with Marco and seeing her interact with other characters is also where a ton of the funny and memorable moments come from, or at least to me. There are several scenes that actually get and still get a good chuckle out of me, and they mostly evolve in Alana. There's actually a pretty good scene where Alana is actually an acting gig, and because of how poor the actual play, I guess, is, and one person in the actual audience actually says it's not very great and that the storyline is terrible, Alana straight up reacts and calls out the member in the audience, essentially breaking the fourth wall. Now, Clara, Marco's mom and Hazel's grandma, actually comes in at the second volume of the series with Bar, her husband and Marco's father. After Bar sadly passes due to a medical condition he has, Clara sticks around with our main group being a main member, at least for a while. Clara's archetype is nothing that original if you've read or watched a lot of stories. The older warrior has to deal with the younger generation type. You can kind of guess how Clara is at the beginning of the series. Granted, she's not annoying or anything, but rather the realist, or rather the pessimist of the group. And during a story arc where she and Hazel is separated from Marco and Alana, she actually does her best despite the situation she and Hazel are in. Isabel, aka the series mascot, is a ghost that actually has a spiritual link to Hazel. Long story short, she was originally on the planet Cleve, and the population of said planet didn't really have an afterlife, and those who die serve as guardians in a way. But due to the war, the entire population was wiped off the map, so you can kind of see the flaws in the evolutionary plan. Hell, Isabel tells Alana this. And after helping Marco and Alana, they agree to let her have a bond with her daughter, as she also serves as Hazel's babysitter. There are many moments of levity, even sincerity, from Isabel. Example being her having a moment to talk to Alana, discussing that life is short, you'll never know when will be the last moment with the love of your life. Gwendolyn, Marco's ex-fiance, serves at least for a while a bit of an antagonist of our main group. The reason she is after them is because, oddly enough, Marco decided to have the bright idea to use Gwendolyn's wedding jewelry for the union for Alana. And since Gwendolyn is not just royally pissed for Marco breaking off the engagement, but using her jewelry for someone else's, we can understand why she's pretty pissed. And when she catches up to our main trio, we actually learn Gwendolyn really did care and love Marco, and him breaking off the engagement really did break her heart. Going deep down, she still has feelings. Something we shall get to. The Will in the world of Saga is a freelancer, pretty much a bounty hunter, and he has been issued by the Wreath government to kill or capture our main trio, and due to several shenanigans actually partners up with Gwendolyn for a while. Now the Will is actually not really a bad person. We actually see him do something rather noble in the first issue, and around the beginning he's not even after Marco or Alana. He's actually trying to rescue a girl from being a sex slave. But as the story goes on, and as time progresses, we see the man physically and mentally deteriorate as the story goes on. But I'm gonna end my discussion of this character here because this ties into my criticism of this series and where I think the Will's original trajectory was meant to be. Now, Saga, at least around the first 40 or so issues, had a consistent level of quality to them. The characters' pacing are all remain top-notch despite a few instances where there might be a hiccup writing-wise, but those hiccups kind of continue further and further and kind of build. And upon recent rereads, it was very apparent that Saga as a series was declining in quality. Certain storylines and arcs would often feel stretched, and among other things that I will go and get into. Now, for those of you who don't really know this already, Saga had a rather massive hiatus after issue 54, a rather pretty infamous issue of the series, if I'm to be honest. And like many others, I was pretty much convinced that Saga would not come back since the series had been on hiatus for 3 years, and unlike manga like Hunter x Hunter or Berserk, which have infamous long breaks between chapters, but those are attributed to things like scheduling or the creator's health, etc., etc., but when it comes to a case like a comic, a Western comic for that matter, If something has been on hiatus for that long, it's less and less likely for it to come back. But you can imagine my surprise when I got the notification that issue 55 was indeed coming out, and admittedly, upon first reading it when it came out, I enjoyed it quite a bit, despite a certain scene, which we shall get to. So my excitement of the series pretty much came back until the rest of the volume came out and recent issues. And after a rereading of Saga in its entirety up to its recent issue, its problems would only continue. Characters that were around in past volumes would leave and never be heard from again. Tone shifts would be more infrequent, and the fun tone of the series became more and more sour as it continued, almost feeling mean-spirited in a way. I won't say downright nihilistic, but rather close. And so let's get into more bullshit. So in volume 9, the volume before the hiatus, the Will catches up to our main group and has a scuffle with Marco, and the fight, despite being short-lived, is pretty well done. It's been consistent in the series that Marco is a formidable fighter, so seeing him go toe-to-toe with the Will was rather a pretty good sight to see, and being a long-term fan of the series actually had my heart going. But when Marco has the upper hand and has Will in a killing stroke, gives up, looks out into space, probably thinks about Hazel, or at least that's what I assume, if that's the case. As the pages are actually structured, you see, assumedly, a flashback with him and Hazel, but upon him reminiscing, the Will gets up behind him and shoves his fucking arm in his chest. And it gets better. In issue 55, the next issue after the hiatus, funny enough, the Will actually shows Gwendolyn Marco's skull as proof he killed him. And Gwendolyn actually starts crying. Tears of joy. You can imagine my reaction to what happens next.
What the fuck?
Sexual healing.
Baby. What the? What?
What about Mel?
Oh, no, wait, hey!
What about
Mel? Hey,
no,
hey, whoa!
Fucking cheater.
What? I don't want to see. No, wait. Whoa, wait, hey. Hey. Oh, whoa! What are you fucking? That's a goddamn sexy! What the fuck is this shit?!
The two fuck right in front of Marco's skull in view. And I'm not the only one who thinks this is tasteless. Several other people who I know personally have told me this moment was where they stopped reading, and I don't blame them. It almost felt as if Brian hated Marco. Like, not only was his death just unearned and very contrived, but this is just disgusting, honestly. And his death is not the only one I take issue with. Remember Isabel? Well, a few volumes ago before this point, she dies too. And at this time, I even thought this death was unearned and was complete shock value as well. But upon further inspection and going back to the very beginning of the series, there is something that actually caught my eye. Clara says something. That disembodied specter? A ghost can't be killed. You can't kill what's already dead. Ryan broke his own world building for the sake of shock value, and I will die on this hill. Now to revisit a point I said earlier when I was discussing the Will, that as the series progressed, the man just deteriorates, almost becoming unrecognizable at certain points. But this character progression was actually well set up in early issues. And on further inspection, it was possible that the Will was actually geared up to be possibly the main villain of Saga. Hazel straight up tells us through narration that the Will was a monster, but in recent issues, in personality and even in mental state, kinda reverted back to his Volume 1 status. Like, all the development and the journey of issue 54 was just wiped away. Was this due to the hiatus, Brian having too much to keep track of, or was I giving Brian too much credit as a writer? And the Will's narrative was something that I imagined. Who knows, honestly? Clara is another thing that I would like to point out. Remember how I said that she was with Hazel and was separated from Marco and Alana? That was because the two ended up in a Lamphalian prison. And when Marco, a few issues later, comes to rescue her and Hazel, Clara has the bright frickin' idea to stay behind. Her reason? She does not want to be a burden to Alana and Marco. And she's lived out her life. Bitch, the fuck you had? You know full well your son, daughter-in-law, and fucking granddaughter are hunted by both governments. The hell do you mean be a burden? What's more insulting is that Marco just nods and takes Hazel and leaves. He does not argue with her, he does not suggest anything, he doesn't even mention Bar, the fact that Hazel never really knew her grandpa, and that the only thing she has to remember him by is a coat he made for her when she was little. That every single second Hazel spends with Clara matters because, as Isabel says, life is short. Clara knows her very existence is something that is a threat to both Lanfell and Reef, and she just stays in a freaking prison. Again, what the fuck? It's as if Brian did not want to write for Clara anymore, so he just wrote her out of the story. Granted, he does show up in recent issues, but it might as well be a cameo. The story does not focus on her, and it's very brief. Now, let's veer off for a bit and jump into a hypothetical situation. How much more interesting if Clara actually stayed with the family? If anything, in a way, the story would have been mostly the same, only a big difference at issue 54. How much more interesting and maybe even heartbreaking would it be if Clara was the one who fought the will, and in fighting, she dies in the process? And have Marco see this and have him lose his mother, have him given to a rage, and hunt down the will and the others who hired him. How much more interesting would it have been had Marco turned into the very monster that he was scared to become, abandon his family and pursue a path of vengeance, maybe even have him hunt down and even fight Gwendolyn, either roles get reversed. See, it's something that I thought up in 2 seconds was way more interesting than anything that is currently coming out in regards to Saga right now, but let's move on to some heavy shit. So, let's not tiptoe and get into the politics of Saga. Now, on this channel, I try not to get political here. I have the Decent podcast for that, but here, I'm gonna lightly break this rule. So, let's talk about a really silly, controversial point in Saga.
Like, I enjoy Saga. Okay, I'm just gonna say, I enjoy Saga. I know a lot of people really don't like Saga because there's this one really fucking ham-fisted moment. There's this one really ham-fisted moment in Saga where they go to a little place called Abortion Town. Oh man. Chat, there's this one moment. I love the zebras. They look like the little gum zebras. I don't know. There's this one moment. I love the design of the owl. She's cute. I love so many of the designs in Saga. But there's this one moment in Saga that I will never get out of my brain where it's this cute little owl. This cute little owl goes on like this tangent about how like white guys are deciding that abortion is bad or whatever and it's wrong because a woman should be allowed to choose what to do with her body. And it's like, whatever you believe, man, go for it, you know? Whatever you believe, okay? I'm not gonna get into the politics side of things. But it was so fucking out of nowhere! It was so out of nowhere! It was so fucking weird! It was like, what the hell? Did I just turn into like a fucking like Saturday drunk special? What the hell?
Yeah. Now, at the time when this issue came out, I honestly didn't mind it that much. In fact, I actually thought it was pretty funny because how absurd it was that there was an entire town for abortions. And in a fucked up way, kind of makes sense in the world of Saga since they're Sextillion, a place where if Amsterdam was juiced up with a shit ton of steroids, though in a fucked up way it kind of works, but under scrutiny, it's clearly like many things in Brian's writing of the series, shock value. Without much context, all people would see is a fully pregnant Alana going to get an abortion. Hell, your boy Zach didn't even finish the issue if I recall correctly when he read it, but in context it does make sense. Alana's child at this point was a stillborn, and since she has a dead fetus in her, that spells health complications, so it's clear they had to go to a back alley abortion clinic to get rid of it due to the nature of Marco and Alana's relationship, and it's almost 100% positive that if the child was born, would be exactly like Hazel, someone with both traits of its parents, so they can't risk anything. That's understandable. But did that really need to be an entire volume? If anything, Brian could have just done a time skip and just focus on the family several months later after the events of the volume prior. And again, this entire volume is rather pointless. Not much happens in the grand scheme of things, at least in regards to our main characters. And another thing to point out is that it is almost like this entire volume is promoting abortion for women's rights, I guess? There would be a few times characters would go on tangents in the past, but it felt like it made sense because it was mostly in regards to the world, and any commentary it was posing was rather surface level and never really felt forced. Examples being how veterans are treated after times of war, governments and corporations popping off of like tragic events of wartime, etc., etc. But here it feels like one nonsense lecture after another, and it does not help that after Saga came back after its hiatus, you have Alana flashing her tits, bitching about the patriarchy and how breastfeeding is bullshit. And yes, I know the context, he's trying to get people to buy some baby formula to get a quick buck, but let's not kid ourselves here. Which is a damn shame, because in a way, Saga was not really woke per se. Well, kinda, it's complicated. When Brian first wrote the series, and you can read about this, the idea was to make a series with non-white leads and really think outside the box. And yeah, you had the occasional panel where Marco would carry Hazel instead of Lana, but it felt natural in a way since both parents were soldiers and could fight. The male characters were never weak, and the female characters never felt overpowered. Everyone had a set of flaws, and there was a sense of things being genuine. Hell, Alana actually says the word retard several times. But yeah, I guess I've pretty much reached my ending point. Summarize, Saga is, or rather was, a fun, exciting series. Despite being in a massive universe, always felt contained. It knew when to be funny, it knew when to shut up and take itself seriously, and at its best, the series was something I, as well as many other people, looked forward to. People cosplayed as Isabel, Lion Cat t-shirts were everywhere. But as the series continued, the writing just loses its quality. Characters started to feel less and less human in a way. The genuine aspect of Saga felt lost. And the fact that Brian thinks that he could extend this series up to 108 issues, which from what I can see online, that plan has not changed. And if this series is already starting to show the cracks now, around 60 issues, I honestly dread what the series might devolve into when or if it reaches that point. There was once a time where I looked forward to seeing Hazel grow up, seeing the pages and issues turn, witnessing this infant take her first steps to later grow up running and flying with her family, seeing her personality develop. Was something that was honestly one of the main draws of Saga for me. I remember having discussions of what it would be like, how cool it would be seeing Hazel being her teens or as a young adult by the end of the series. What level of magic would she be able to do? How would the galaxy react to seeing her? What can she do? What will she do? Was she actually like downplaying how much of an effect she had on the world? Does she make an effect at all? Does the galaxy change? Does the war still happen? We don't know. But with recent issues, that desire to go back, that desire to speculate has dwindled with each reread. Seeing Hazel no longer be the bond between two people hunted by the very worlds they used to call home, now just being another face on the cover is rather saddening. Seeing this cute, innocent character grow no longer felt like it mattered. Seeing Hazel's journey into this world felt less and less fun. There's less of a reason to go back to it. And that is why Saga is disappointing. To quote a YouTuber I like, this video took far too long to make. To those of you who stuck around to the very end, you have my thanks. This video was honestly really painful to make, and it hurts even more knowing that this actually is my second video regarding Saga. You can find the first one linked down below in the description, but fair warning, it's an early vid. I'm not using a pop filter in it, and I'm very close to the mic, I'm whispering, and they're or several moments that I cringe at. Though my criticisms are on point, but honestly, some of it aren't. That's kind of why I made this, because Saga's back now, and there's a lot I have to say about it. So, will I do another one of these when its current volume finishes? Who knows? Maybe I'll talk about it on stream or the podcast, but we'll see. But hopefully soon, I'll be back to reviewing stuff that is actually fun to read. So on that note, be sure to like, leave a comment, the usual stuff, subscribe, and as always, catch you guys later. Stay chill, Wanderers.